Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship, and we want to welcome you if you're watching at home today. A few announcements to lift up for you. Again, we'd remind you that our all-church conference is coming up on the 3rd of December, and we're looking to have reports in for that around the beginning of November so that we can put out the booklet. We're also beginning to receive Advent devotionals for our annual Advent devotional, which will be available online and in print form. And the theme for Advent this year is What the World Needs. What the World Needs. So we'd encourage you to get that in by the 3rd or 4th of November, and that will be helpful. We're in stewardship season here at the church, so hopefully over the next day or two, you will receive your stewardship mailing from Prescott United Methodist. We encourage you to open that up and read the letter and prayerfully discern how you will financially support your church over the next year. So watch your mailboxes. Let's continue our time of worship through our prelude.
Hear now the call to worship. We belong to God.
God's stamp is on our lives.
God's love and compassion is built into us, calling us to serve others and reflect God's love to all people.
God's mercy and hope flow through us, challenging us to be the best church we can be.
Let us celebrate the powerful presence of God. Let us affirm God's goodness in this place.
Let's rejoice in all the opportunities God gives us to serve. Let us proclaim His good news to all the nations. Amen.
I have heard thy voice, and it told me, love to
Come now to our time of prayer, and as every week for recent weeks, we give thanks for the beauty of this day and that we can be together in worship. At the same time, we need to boldly pray for rain right now. We much need rain to come and refresh us and to help with the fire danger. And so we pray for our local firefighters as they continue to fight the horse fire at Crown King. Prayers this week for Pat Noretto, who will be having surgery on Wednesday, October 21st. And continued prayers for all those who are ill with the virus, who have recovered, for family members who are taking care of those who are ill, for family members who grieve the deaths of those who have died. We continue to hold up all those who take care of those who are suffering with this illness. And so we come now to our time of corporate prayer. Let us pray. As we come together in worship, we turn our thoughts and hearts toward you, O God. We give thanks for your constant and abiding presence. We give thanks for each one here, and we remember those who are not here in person, but are always in our thoughts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Gracious God, you are our sustainer and redeemer. You catch us when we fall. Today, move us by your Spirit and give us grace to share one another's burdens and love each other as you have loved us. Help us to step forward in the name of peace and justice. Lord, we pray for all those who are experiencing pain and are suffering in the face of hardship. We continue to pray for those who are struggling in the aftermath of fires and hurricanes, who now face the challenges of rebuilding their lives. And we pray for and give thanks for those courageous men and women who put their lives at risk to rescue and to bring aid and comfort to those in need. We pray for those everywhere who serve you and love you, O God. Give us compassionate and loving hearts as we live and work in our communities and in your world. We pray that you will watch over those who serve and govern our cities and our country. Guide them and give them wisdom and courage in the work that they do and the decisions that they make. God of grace, we hear your call to generous giving. By the way, you hear our prayers and meet our needs every day. We have received so much from you, and we offer back what we have, our time, our talents, our service, our gifts. We give back to you. Hear us now as we join our hearts and our voices in the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture lesson today is from the 22nd chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew, verses 15 through 22. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
This is a popular passage. A few weeks ago, Pastor Dan and I talked about me preaching this particular passage, and he said something like, "This is a well-known passage. It's not very complicated. It shouldn't be too hard." And I've been thinking about that because people shouldn't underestimate my ability to overcomplicate things. I'm actually pretty good at that. So as we begin this moment of reflection, would you pray with me? Holy God, we thank you for the opportunity to be together and reflect on your word. Work in our hearts. Let it bear fruit in us, God, so that we may leave this place as new creatures. Help us be doers of your word, not just hearers. So it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Uh, So like I said, pretty common passage. You probably have heard it before. The Pharisees, the religious authorities of the time, want to get Jesus in trouble. They come to him with adulation and ask him, is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? But Jesus knew what they were up to and calls them out. Then he says, show me the coin used for the tax. And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, whose head and whose title are these on the coin? And they said, the emperor's. And then he responds with, give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. And they were amazed by this response and left him. Now, the words of Jesus, they often leave room for interpretation. And I have heard this particular passage interpreted in different ways. I think the most common interpretation that I have heard has to do with the separation of church and state. God represents the church, some people say, and the emperor represents the state. And so Jesus is basically saying that those two should not mix. Well, I do agree that not one particular religious organization should have political power over others. I don't find this interpretation particularly compelling. You see, there was no such thing as a church back then. And there wasn't really a state as we know it either. The church and the state developed later in history, and so they are not things that Matthew has in mind. To say that this is about the separation of church and state would be anachronistic. It would also be wrong to say that rulers of the time were entirely secular. In fact, the title on that coin that Jesus was holding read Tiberius Caesar, son of the divine Augustus. So we can see that they attributed a certain divinity to their rulers back then. They didn't compartmentalize things the way we do today. And so there were members of the Jewish community who believed that this was a blasphemous affirmation. After all, they only believed in the one God, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. These were competing ideologies, and the Pharisees used this tension to try to get Jesus in trouble. You see, if Jesus said that it was lawful to pay taxes, a group of people would get upset because he would be affirming the authority of Caesar. If he said that it was not lawful, other group of people would get upset because he was rejecting it. You know, I think a lot of pastors and religious leaders understand this feeling today. We live in a very divided, partisan environment. We know what it is to have to make a statement sometimes, and knowing that some people are just not going to be happy with it. The difference being, of course, that Jesus could lose his life, and eventually did so for sharing his message. So here's what I believe that Jesus is doing. I think Jesus is challenging this binary mentality itself. The question itself is wrong, Jesus states. You see, when Jesus shows the coin to the people, he points the image on it and says, whose face is this? And whose title? Again, they said, this is the image of Caesar. Well, then you should give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. But here's the thing. Once he asks that question, then we should inevitably ask where it is that we find God's image. Because that belongs to God. And where is it that we find God's image? Where can we find God's stamp? Well, if we read the book of Genesis, we understand that we are all created in God's image. We have God's stamp on us, and so does creation, which tells the glory, tells about the glory of God. These coins, sure, give them to Caesar, pay your taxes, no problem. But know that there are things that Caesar did not create. There are things that Caesar does not own. You are all created by God. Caesar himself was created by God. How is that for a political statement? So there's at least a couple of things that we glean from this passage. Number one, we should avoid every now and then that compartmentalization of our lives. By this, I mean that we should understand everything that we have as coming from God's hand. And number two, our own giving should reflect this understanding. So it is hard for us to fully comprehend a statement like this. With time, we have separated life into different compartments. We have all these things that we have that we attend to, and we want to maintain appropriate boundaries between them. Some people will speak about their family life, their work life, a social life. We don't just have life anymore. Everything has to fit in fit neatly into a box. And we do this with everything. We do it with our relationship with God as well. Friends, I believe we have developed a theology of separation. We draw certain lines and we tell God not to cross them. There are things that belong to God and things that don't belong to God. Here's what God does, and here's what we do. I sometimes see this theology of separation when people get sick. And they take them to a hospital. And doctors work on this individual for as much as they can. And there comes a point when there's nothing else that they can do. And they have this phrase that they say, where they say, well, this person is in God's hands now. Have you heard this phrase before? And there's something that bothers me about that phrase. Are you saying this person was not in God's hands before? What does that mean? Friends, we are always in God's hand. And I see this compartmentalization in giving as well. I once had a conversation with a person at church a long time ago, and I learned about something that she called second mile giving. I asked the person what she meant by that, and she said, well, it's giving more than what is required of us. And at that point, I had to ask, well, how much is required of us? She said, 10%. Well, again, that doesn't make much sense to me, because certainly we read in scripture about tithing, but there's not just one tithe that people attended to at that time. It was much more than 10%. We read in Numbers 18 that there was a sacred tithe. We read in Deuteronomy 14 that there was a tithe of the feasts. We read in that same chapter that there was a separate tithe for the poor. So there were a lot of tithes that people had to attend to, which is different from what a lot of people believe today, which is just the one tithe, right? One of my professors said, you know, people came up with this 10% thing, not because it was a lot, but actually because it was the minimum that they could give. And they adopted it and shared that message, that it was 10% that we were required to give. And some may be saying, well, hold on, Pastor, that seems like a lot. And I say, no, don't worry. God does not require a lot, really. No, God requires everything. Because God has given you everything. These compartments, these sections that we have in our lives were created by ourselves. Well, these compartments, they cannot contain God. We cannot put God in a box. God's grace indeed extends to all parts of our lives and invites us to live lives of integrity. And one way in which we can define integrity is whole and undivided. Everything in our lives belongs to God. And so we say goodbye to this theology of separation. There is no God and Caesar. There's no competing ideologies. There's only God. And yes, we should pay our taxes. But we should also know that there's something beyond a certain amount that we give. And it's the dedication of our lives to the higher ideals of Jesus Christ. Friends, when we give, that should be our starting point. That should be our beginning to understand that everything that we have received from God. And we are made stewards of those things. We are not owners. We are trustees. We are administrators of God's belongings. And we have to ask for wisdom constantly to do a good job in that regard. I like the way John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, put it. He said, you should earn all the money you can, save all the money you can, and give all the money you can. Friends, this is not extra mile giving. This is a lifestyle. Let's look at each of these for just a moment. I feel like our culture is pretty good at sharing that message of that first part. Earn all the money you can. We are a competitive group, aren't we? We like to earn as much money as we can. We see that. Sometimes we see that as a success. We equal the earning of money to success. A lot of our decisions that we make are based on the bottom line. But yet, it's not just the accumulation of money that we should be concerned about. We should be concerned about being good stewards of the things that God provides to us. So I'm not very concerned about the first one. I think that message, we're very familiar with it. The second part of it, though, can be a little more difficult. Save all the money you can. A lot of people struggle with that one. It requires effort. It requires some kind of measure in the way that we spend our resources. Notice that we don't find one rule that says spend all the money you can, right? Some of us sometimes may live by that rule, but that's not a rule that comes from Wesley, right? He says, save all the money that you can. Now, the third one is just hard. In my experience, it may be easier for you, and if that's the case, God bless you. Give all that you can. It's such a fundamental teaching. And it's, friends, something that each of us have to figure out. We have to figure out what it means and what it looks like in our own lives. Because you see, I think the amount that we give may vary, but the responsibility is the same. All Christians, you, me, Pastor Dan, Pastor Patty, everybody, we have this responsibility that we are entrusted with to be generous givers. Again, generosity looks different for different people, and you have to prayerfully consider what that looks like for you. But I do believe that just as we often think about just not giving more than we can, we have to be very careful about not giving less than we can. I do believe it's just as important. So these three things, as I said, are not concerned with amounts. They're not concerned with a percentage. They're concerned with a mentality, with a lifestyle, with a recognition, like I said, that everything that we have comes from God, and that we are made responsible of these resources, not just for our own benefit, but the benefit of others. We are to be concerned with the poor, with the widow, with the needy. We are to bless other people just as we have been blessed. And we are to respond to God's blessings with gratitude. And I just want to conclude with this. I didn't want this sermon to just be about the mechanics of giving. I want to talk a little bit about the fuel that should drive this spiritual discipline in our lives, because giving is a spiritual discipline. I do believe, friends, that we need to maintain joy in all the things that we do. Giving should not be something that we do because we have to do it. Giving should not be something that we do because it's just, what we're told to do. Giving, friends, is a response to God's grace. It's a response to God's generosity. And I understand that this church has been very generous in its history. And that fills me with joy. This is a giving church. This is a church that cares about the community. My exhortation for you, just like it is my exhortation for myself, is to maintain the joy of giving as we do this. Let's keep it a spiritual discipline. Let us understand that it's just as much about our relationship with God as it is about our relationship with other people. Let us understand that through this process, we are blessed, even as we bless others. That through the process of giving, God continues to build in us and to shape us and to mold us to be the church that God has created us to be. A generous church, a loving church, driven by compassion, driven by love. That is the fuel behind our actions. So let us affirm God's blessing as we give. Let us affirm God's blessing as we share those things that we have received. And let us model, let us set the tone to demonstrate, and I love this concept, an extravagant generosity. Extravagant generosity. Again, not extra mile giving, but a lifestyle. A way to worship. A way to declare God's goodness in this place. Can you say amen?
Amen.
You know, I have found that some sermons are very easy for people to say amen to. In my experience, I'm sometimes concerned about stewardship sermons. And by the end of it, I usually ask people, can you still say amen? And if they can still say amen, I praise God with them because it's an important reminder. So let us continue as we leave this place to hold these truths in our heart, to continue to be that generous church, and to affirm God's goodness through our ministry. Let me ask you once again, can you still say amen?
Amen.
Let it be so. I do have a question for you today. Were you blessed today in our reunion? If you were blessed today, that's always a tricky question to ask. It's never happened to me, but people may say no, and that puts me in a tough position. But if you were blessed today, go and be a blessing. go and continue to share that message of love and grace that we have received, friends. We live in a world that desperately needs to hear it. And may God continue to bless you and to keep you and to give you strength wherever you go. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Friends, God bless you. Go in peace.